Ladies and gentlemen, Stephen Amell. This is our third Q&A together.
Yes, it is.
Third time's the charm. Thanks for coming back to Dallas.
I missed you.
Of course, I've missed you too. You complete me. So, the last time you were here was a fantastic build-up because where Arrow was at that point, it was where you had just kind of come back.
Yes.
And so, again, I think this week's episode is another great build-up because we've seen some really big things happen, and there's some huge tension coming up. So, I'm not going to ask for any spoilers, but is there anything you can tell us about what we can expect maybe in the next few episodes?
No.
No, okay.
No, there's, we have some returning favorites. Cupid is coming back to the show.
Cool.
Amy does a fantastic job with that character. I like that character. We are going to meet in a couple of later episodes a few villains from previous seasons that we haven't seen since then. And then there's that whole who's in the grave thing.
Right, yeah. Why don't you just tell everybody right now who's in the grave?
Guys, turn off your phones and I'll
just make up. We'll put it out there a little viral. It could be the wrong thing, you know?
I would say my only spoiler with that would be that just because it's something that we've teased since the beginning of the season does not mean that it won't happen until the end of the season.
Okay. Good.
So enjoy.
By the way, I'm hoping everybody's caught up on Arrow because there's probably going to be some spoilers that we discuss here, but I really enjoyed the way you Vadered Arrow, man. That's something I saw somebody mention, and I thought that was a great way to put it. You Vadered him.
I Vadered him. Yeah, I cut his hand off. Well, he deserved it.
Yeah.
Somebody was saying to me earlier, a family came up to me, and they were like, but you should have killed him. Look at what he's done. Look at everything that he has done. You should have killed him. You should have killed him. Why didn't you kill him? And I thought about it for a second, and I think that my answer is something that I'm going to be able to use going forward. Good decisions make for bad television. Bad decisions, good television.
Well, and based on what just happened, I think you may have even more motivation now to get your revenge at some point, depending on how things play out.
Yeah, the dangling carrot of my estranged son and his mother in danger is something that we're going to address very, very soon on the show.
Another great standout episode, I think, this season was you guys did a phenomenal job of introducing Vandal Savage to the whole universe.
Yeah.
And the crossover episode with The Flash. I mean, that's got to be so much fun to shoot those episodes. There's so much going on in those episodes.
It's a ton of fun. We've had a ton of fun this year with the mystical elements, with the magical elements. Oh, a character that we have coming is Vixen from the animated series. So that's very exciting, and I mean, I've gotten to do stuff this year that I never envisioned being able to do. We have an episode of Legends of Tomorrow coming up called Star City 2046, which is exactly what it sounds like, and I get to do some things as Oliver Queen that I really never thought that I would do.
Yeah.
And we get to introduce an absolutely critical character in sort of the Arrow timeline that I don't think we ever would have been able to introduce on Arrow. So we get to do our own Legends.
How does it feel now that you've had the four seasons under your belt and, you know, being able to know that, I mean, because genre shows like this don't always get a chance to breathe, and you guys are really getting a nice run. So now that you've got four seasons under your belt, like, what is the feeling with the cast and everybody right now? Does it feel like you guys are the best is yet to come, or what are you feeling at this point?
Well, I'm getting excited because I feel like the show was built to be 5 years long. Now, it's not going to end after season five.
Did you hear what Stephen Amell just said?
27 more episodes, we're done. No, it's not going to end after season five, but we did build in a five-year story. So to me, I feel like we're gaining a little bit of momentum right now, but we have a real opportunity through the end of this year and through season five to really put a button on that whole flashback story. There's so much stuff that we have to get done in the flashbacks that I almost feel like I'm putting off an assignment. Like, I talk to the writers every once in a while, I'm like, I've made a list of things from the flashbacks. Have you? Like, no, we have. Okay.
I want to get to the audience question too, because we got a lot of people lined up, but I did want to ask you briefly about playing Casey Jones in Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, because I'm a huge fan. And that really is like such a stinking cool character to be able to take on. So can you talk a little bit about what that experience was like, and was there a lot of freedom to interpretation on that role?
There was, and the thing that I like about it is that on paper, Casey Jones and Oliver Queen, both super powerless vigilantes, would seem like a similar character, but I believe me when I tell you that I don't find any Oliver in Casey. And so it was a really nice opportunity for me after three seasons of Arrow, and it's so difficult to schedule something during my hiatus because it's so short. The fact that I got to go and play that and stretch out a little bit was so much fun. And you know, for Turtles fans, there's really nothing that you're not getting in this movie. You're getting an awesome Shredder. Brian T is fantastic. Bebop and Rocksteady, and you know, from the Super Bowl commercial, it certainly looks like Krang.
I almost don't want to see more until it comes out because it's like
you're
so exciting.
There'll be one more. There'll be one more trailer. Yeah, we haven't really told the story of what it is yet.
Yeah, very cool. You got your hockey sticks skills down, I hope.
That's right.
All right, listen, I want to make this about you guys. So let's turn it over to the audience. We're going to start here, then we'll go here, and we'll go back and forth. Let's try to go as fast as we can because I know we got a lot of people in mind. Let's start right here.
Do you know who Artemis is, and will she be coming on the show soon or later?
Who?
Artemis.
Yes.
I do know who Artemis is. I don't think that there are any plans to bring her on anytime soon.
Sorry.
hi, my name is Elle, and I was wondering, like, what sort of martial arts what training you do to film the show, if there's any?
So the best way that I can put it is that, you know, I do my training with my trainer Thomas up in Vancouver, and but for the show, one of the things that I've become more proficient at as we move through the seasons is the skill of fighting on television, the skill of fighting, you know, televised martial arts, I suppose, because I feel like fighting for the camera is a specific type of skill. If the camera is right there and the person that you're gonna punch in the face is right here, there's a specific way that you should swing to make it look like that punch actually connects. And I've gotten to know that without having to be told anymore. I've also gotten a lot better at, during the pilot and during some early episodes of the show, we would have tons of time to put fights together. That's not so much the case anymore. I'm really learning those fights on the fly, and I'm really good at coming in talking to I'd like to think I'm pretty good at coming in, talking to our fight choreographer, Stephen Amell says he's excellent at, and having him say, here are these eight moves, you know, pop, 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 pop. And I, what? Okay, show me again. Pop, 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 pop. I go in, I kind of do it, I do a little bit quicker, and then roll the cameras. So that's something that I've gotten better at.
I'll say it, you are pretty good.
Thank you.
Right over here.
Hi, my name is Crystal. I was wondering, how is it like to play a hero, and would you ever change that to play a villain?
Yes. I actually got a little bit worried. I got a little bit worried because my first, you know, six or seven jobs, the only time that I wasn't playing a villain, I was playing a hooker. So you start taking long looks at yourself in the mirror, going, is there something wrong? Why are people identifying this one very evil trait in me? I do enjoy playing someone that is heroic and that always strives to do the right thing, even when that doesn't always mean making the right decision. But some of my favorite moments for Oliver is when we see a flaw in him, when we see the elements that aren't heroic, because I think that humanizes the character, makes it a little bit more relatable, and you know, I like making people mad.
I saw some dark stuff with you asking where Damian Dark was, so it's kind of a darker side of Oliver there.
Yeah, and that was important. There are a few elements of the character that, you know, as we move through the show, And as we keep trying to push the envelope, you can't push it so far that you get away from the core elements of the show that made people enjoy it in the first place.
Right.
I mean, you can certainly go to the well one too many times, but at the same time, that's the character. I read online, I know a lot of fans were upset that, you know, Oliver wasn't truthful with Felicity, and I mean, I thought that it was fascinating, if not a lot of fun. Because
yeah.
It's obviously going to come back and bite him in the ass.
Can you shoot a bow and arrow? If so, good.
So awesome. That's like the best way to ask that question.
Yes. And yes.
Fantastic. Thanks. Let's keep all the questions.
I wish every question was like that.
Right here.
That's a great question. I got the role of Oliver Queen because the show that I had been on previously on HBO was canceled. So it was canceled in late December, and at the time I was working as a guest star on Private Practice, and the role of, you know, the pilot of Arrow came up. Robbie, my cousin, told me about it, and was like, you should audition for this because, you know, they want me to audition, and I read it, and all I could picture was you doing it, and it pissed me off. So you should definitely read for that. And I said, I'm sure I will. And the only thing that was unnerving about the audition process was how seamless it was. I was the first person to audition. Shortly after the audition, the director of the pilot told me that I was going to be cast as Oliver. But then I still had to go and test for the network and test for the studio and then be approved by the head of CBS, and not just the CW. And so it was scary because it felt like everything was going so perfectly that I was just waiting for the other shoe to drop. But then I got the call, and that was a little more than 4 years ago now.
Nice. Better.
Do the stunts scare you? Yes. How or no?
They do. The stunts are scary. I had a fight in Ninja Turtles with Bebop and Rocksteady before they become the Bebop and Rocksteady that we all know. And the guy that was playing Rocksteady, his name is Stephen Farrelly, but WWE fans would know him as Sheamus. And Sheamus is utterly terrifying. And I had to run at him, and he had to pretend to headbutt me, and I was convinced that he was going to kill me. And then, of course, with Arrow, there'll be certain things where, you know, it'll be a jump, or swinging down from the tree, or something, and I'm always very demonstrative and going, you're going to let me do this, no one else is going to do this, it's me, it's not a double. But I'm kind of afraid of heights. So I get up there and I go, whoo, 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 and then I try to look cool.
Hi,
I'm Sabrina.
Hi, Sabrina.
So supposedly Oliver and Felicity are gonna break up in the next episode or something bad like that.
You know what? I saw you were fishing for spoilers earlier. By talking about things like they had happened, trying to get me to slip up. You won't catch me, Sabrina.
Well, is there anything you can say, maybe about, like, to give us hope the next time you
I will give you some hope, okay? Obviously, at some point this year, the chickens are going to come home to roost for Oliver, and Felicity will likely find out that I have, a 10-year-old kid. But I will tell you that if that happens, I promise that they will handle it like adults.
Nice.
I'm loyal and who's in the grave?
They just don't give up. Just tell us who's in the grave. Come on. Well, that makes sense. That no, that makes sense.
No, I can't tell you who's in the grave. I can tell you that I think it's a super interesting storytelling technique. And I don't enjoy the prevailing sense of dread that it has given both the fan base and, to be totally honest, the actors on the show. Because nobody knows. When that scene was filmed at the beginning of the season, nobody knew. So that's been tough. That's been tough.
So like the reverse shot, there's nothing on the tombstone. You have no idea what's on that tombstone.
When I shot the scene, I went to the EPs and I said, "Do you know?" And they said, "Even if we did, we wouldn't tell you." So I then asked them some questions and I said, "Okay, well, how should I react? You've got to give me a ballpark because I have to have something in my mind's eye." And they helped me with that.
Yeah.
Because we can't, you know, the scene in reverse has to make sense, right? Because it has to fit in seamlessly whenever we catch up to when that scene took place.
Okay.
Who do you think would win in a battle, you or Zoom from Flash?
Took down a reverse Flash, no problem. Someone holding still, I'll punch him in the face. Done. I hope that answers your question. By the way, this causes some controversy, right? But I always get asked, you know, who would win in a fight? Green Arrow or Superman? Green Arrow or Batman? And of course, I'm always going to say Green Arrow. And I mean, like, always. Always, always, always. And then I caught some flack on the internet for saying that I would beat Batman in a fight. And part of it was caused by my own cousin who guffawed at the notion. Like, Robbie, you're being a dick. Sorry for my language. You really pissed me off. I know you like Batman, but keep your thoughts to yourself. By the way, he's on X-Files. Watch it if you want.
Hello, I'm Liam Inox. I'm the guy that did those Flight Sim Saturday photoshops for you.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I have one question about, I'm an aspiring film major, so I want to know how is it like working with multiple different directors and the process that you have to go through when they film one episode one way and the next episode a different way.
It's really interesting because we have directors on the show. We had a director who directs episode 415, and his name is Gregory Smith, and he is, I think, 2 years younger than I am, and worked with Greg Berlanti, our main executive producer, all the way back to Everwood, and is an incredible director and has a real eye for it and is so organized and highly efficient, and I love working with Greg. And then, meanwhile, our director on the episode that I just finished, Michael Schultz, is in his 70s, and he has a totally different tenor and speed. We've had James Bamford direct an episode this year, and he's our stunt choreographer, or, you know, is when he is not directing. He's also directing the episode that is airing this Wednesday. And so it's nice, because I'm always excited when the new director comes in. But by the time we get to the eighth day, I'm like, when are they going to get rid of this guy? And then, of course, I'm excited when they come back. So, and also, one of the great things that happens on a show as you get into year four is we've had a couple of brand new directors this year that are from within our crew, both James Bamford and Gord Verhall, who directed the episode that just aired. And, you know, Gord has been the director of photography on Arrow since season one. And when he gets to move up and direct, that means that the head of the lighting department gets to come up and be the director of photography. So it's really neat to see, you know, guys that were dolly grips for the camera in season one are now operating, you know, B camera and C camera in season four. And that's a hyper rewarding thing. I've been working on a gift for the Arrow crew. I've been working on it since 2012, okay? On Monday, from 3 o'clock until 5 o'clock, the Stanley Cup is coming to set.
Nice.
You guys remember the Stars won the Cup, right? The Stanley Cup. It's mainly me taking a dig because they're all Canucks fans. Like, they're all really excited. They're like, is the cup coming? Is the cup coming? And I go, yeah, how else is it going to come to Vancouver? So it's a double-edged sword for them, but they'll be happy ultimately.
What a guy. What a guy. Right here.
Hi, my name is Ian. Hi, Ian. Is your favorite Pokemon?
You better get this right.
I don't know.
It's gotta be Charizard, right?
Is it Charizard? Can I tell a, since that was a question aimed at younger people that I wasn't able to answer, can I tell a fun story about my daughter? Quickly? So my daughter just wanted to climb out of her crib, right? Which is, it's always great in the middle of the night to hear. So anyway, she learns to climb out of her crib. We put her back in her crib. The following morning, we say, Maddie, you cannot climb out of your crib. We're gonna get you a big girl bed, but it is dangerous. You need to stay in your bed. Do you understand? Do you understand that it's dangerous? Yes. You gonna do it again? No. Okay, now, my daughter's just about to be 2.5. Maddie, why did you climb out of your crib? And I swear to God, she goes, it's my life!
Hi, Stephen.
Hi.
Please, first, say hi to my OECD friends.
Hi. Oh, you asked me to do this last year, didn't you?
Yes.
Hello, OECD friends.
We're close to the 44,000.
Good for you guys.
Yeah. And my question is, could you please share some funny history with Emily filming a OECD scene?
You know, working with Emily and being serious, one of the really nice things is that having shot so much content with her, I never get bored of it, and scenes are always super interesting. They never are what they appear to be on the page when you first read the script. And but as for a funny one, we have this running joke right now where right before a take, I'll just take my hand and I'll just go like that, which makes no sense at all until you work 14 hours a day with someone, and then it becomes incredibly funny. So just know that before any intimate moment, I have, like, draped my hands across her face like a spider. When there were two Felicities, when there was Felicity hallucinating, I thought that, I mean, the way that they did that, just in terms of technically, what I thought was very, very interesting, but we actually got a great actor who has since been on Legends to come in and play either regular Felicity or hallucination Felicity, and it was just like, it was fascinating. It was a really, really interesting scene to do when I'm arguing and she's yelling and Felicity goes, shut up! That was a blast to film.
Right.
Out of all the annoying things Robbie has done, which has been the most frustrating?
I think we talked about it already. No, Robbie's not annoying. I'll tell you, Robbie, he has a project coming up that we're going to be talking about more soon, and I think we're going to see some footage from within about a month or two. And that guy is always working. Like, he's on The Flash, he's on X-Files, he's in Toronto right now, he's filming a movie, and I'm always behind him. I'm like, wait, what are you doing? And he's not annoying, he's just, you know, a little shorter than I am.
Right here.
How are you doing? Good. I was actually wondering, I'm pretty sure sharing this experience with Robbie has had its ups and downs with you.
No, but not at all.
But I was wondering, when you guys first started doing this, did you guys expect either Flash or Arrow to blow up as big as they did?
No, I mean, of course not. You know, we were going to, we didn't really become super close until I moved to Los Angeles in 2010. Because, you know, I am 7 years older than he is, and that's an interesting gap to have when you're 20 and he's 13. It becomes more palatable when, you know, I'm 29 and he's 22. But we've had a blast, you know, and he is a guy that, especially when I moved to Los Angeles, that I really looked up to, because he had a way about him and he had a calmness about him, and there was an efficiency to his work and the way that he approached acting that I did not possess. I was incredibly analytical. I would totally outthink myself. I would get right into my own head, and he'd just go, see job, book job. And I'd like to think that maybe there's a few things that he's learned from me, but I certainly learned that from him.
I was going to go with Oracle, but that was already taken. Was that an ad-lib line, or was it actually in the script?
That was in the script. That was in the script. Yeah. Can I make a confession? I had no idea what it meant. I had no idea what it meant. And then the internet goes like that. So I thought it was cool. But no, that was written. There have been a fair number of ad-libs this year, and I never try to steal away the script or to sort of bogart a scene, as the case may be. I always try to make sure that if they wanted to leave the ad-lib on the cutting room floor, it could be, so it's not right in the middle of something. It tends to be at the end, but they've kept a lot of them, and I will say that I was very, very grateful. There's a scene at the end of episode 15. And I was incredibly appreciative of the way that it was shot and cut. We tend to have a lot of cuts on our show, and sometimes things don't necessarily get the room to breathe because so much is packed in to 41 and a half minutes. But this particular scene is, it's like 3.5-4 minutes long. And aside from cut aways to certain montage things, the camera never cuts off me. It's really cool. Yeah.
Hi. I was wondering.
I'm delivering a eulogy. I'm not, I promise.
So there's Felicity and there's Thea. They're both dying. You can only save one of them. Which one would you say?
Oh, you're gonna. You're gonna good son me right now? No way I'm answering that question. You understand that I have to work with both of them on Monday morning, don't you? Voice go up like 4 octaves when I got uncomfortable. That's what I want to know. She would find a third option. I'd cut off Malcolm's other hand.
Wow. Double Vader.
I'm Ariel, like the Little Mermaid. I just wanted to ask you if there was anything you could tell us about your appearance on Legends of Tomorrow.
Yeah, the makeup took 3.5 hours. I have never been more uncomfortable because any time that I moved my face, it was like an exposed nerve. And after about 4 hours, I was really afraid that I was gonna tear it off. And we get it. We get the classic goatee. That's cool. And we get, you know. We get a possible view into Oliver's future and in the state of Star City. And we get a familiar nemesis. Not in the sense that we've seen him before, but in a familial sense.
Mm. Make of that what you will. Right here.
Hi, I'm a big Turtle fan, so I'm just wondering if we're gonna get the between Raphael and John Casey that we got in the first movie.
Yeah, they hate each other. Raph and Casey do not get along in this second Turtles movie, and that was really fun, especially because Alan Richardson, who plays him, is like a big, imposing, intimidating guy, and you know, he and I worked together on Blue Mountain State once upon a time. So we had a, you know, It was nice. You should check out that movie, by the way. Those guys did a really good job. They crowdsourced a movie, they made it. I haven't seen it, my buddy Zacho saw it, said it's really good. So it was nice that stuff and that antagonistic element between Raph and Casey, which is commonplace in the comic books and of course from the earlier movies, it was nice that I was able to have that with Alan because we kind of had this built-in chemistry. I hope.
Right here. My name's Grant, and since you helped Barry fight the Reverse Flash, will you help Barry fight him?
All Barry's gotta do is pick up the phone. Or speed in and speed out and come get me. I'm always game for a fight. Yeah, for sure. I would help Barry. Always. Good guy, that Barry Allen. A little cheery for me, but good guy. I'm actually very excited. I'm a little bit behind on The Flash, but I of all the stuff that I've read and everything, them going to Earth 2 and everything, it's just been awesome.
Incredible.
Super good?
Absolutely incredible. Yeah, it's just so good. Sorry.
Tell us how you really feel.
It's not as good as Arrow, but it's good.
It's not what I was saying.
Hi, my name is Angel. I wanted to ask if you and Emily ever got the MTV Ship of the Year award, and if you'll ever do that video you promised.
I know that the video has been promised. We have the cokes. We have an idea. One thing that I will tell you, and this is not an excuse for not doing it earlier in the year. Emily and I have not been working together that much recently. Make this what you will.
So,
where's Sabrina? Ask him. She's gonna stand up again. Ask for another sport.
My name is Eric. Today is my 23rd birthday.
Happy birthday, man. I'm gonna give you a tip. As you get older, you should start calling your birthdays based off of famous athletes. Like, so you just turned Michael Jordan.
It's not Michael Jordan here, right here.
Appreciate it. It could be your greatest.
So my question is, do you and your fellow co-stars ever refer to each other as your on-stage name when you're not going?
No. John sometimes calls me Oliver every once in a while, but he immediately corrects himself. But we more have like nicknames, but not certainly not our stage names. Diggle every time that he's Diggle. I just think that's Diggle. That was not on purpose, by the way. I'm not talented enough for that to be on purpose. No, but every time that I see David first thing, whenever I see him first thing in the morning, he only calls me this once a day, but the first time I see him, he'll go,
So, this could technically be spoilery, but they did say that on Earth 2, Oliver is dead and Robert is the Arrow.
Yeah.
But if you, maybe on a different Earth, could play it Oliver, what would you want him to be like?
Just totally different. Actually, you know what would be interesting within the dynamics of Earth 1, Earth 2, Earth 3, Earth 4, Earth negative 1? How does that work? It would be really interesting if he was just exactly the same. You know what I mean? Like, everyone else is totally different, he's just all curmudgeon-y and going, like, can you picture two Olivers who are just both equally, like, dour and pissed off and not at each other? Yeah, it would be interesting to play Oliver Queen as a different version, actually. So I'd leave that in the hands of the writers.
Right here.
Why do you think the people of Arrow want you to take your shirt off so much?
When you're a little older, you'll understand. I would take my shirt, if I didn't have 90 minutes of makeup and prosthetics to apply, and they have to paint in the abs and stuff like that, I'm kidding. Then I would be shirtless way more often. If it was just a matter of like pulling my shirt off and being shirtless, I'd be shirtless all the time. Great motivation, because it's absolutely terrifying. But yeah, it takes so long. I don't know, it's kind of become a staple of the show. And again, Oliver's scars and, you know, his physique are kind of a roadmap for where he's been. So it's an important part of the character.
He's not saying anymore.
Hello. Hi. I want to say, first of all, it's good to meet you and talk to you earlier.
Thank you.
I appreciate everything you do. And I just want to say for Colton Haynes, I'm a big fan of his. I'm thankful that he came out, and I'm a big fan of his. So I appreciate the show, and I love you. I love him. I'm so glad to be here. I'm from Houston, Texas. So good to see you.
Good to see you too, man. Thank you.
So beautiful. Y'all are beautiful. I love y'all.
Thank you very much. It's nice that I pulled you back.
Oh. Hi, I'm Samia. Nice to meet you. Big fan. So what was your favorite scene in filming in last season of Arrow, and why?
It was the scene where I lost to Roz. That was just such a cool, day. So to understand, I really honestly believe that we have the most gifted, hardest working crew in all of television. For them to pull off what we pulled off, first of all, we're on top of Grouse Mountain in Vancouver. We brought in snow in case we needed it. We did not, it was snowing. And we're pulling off a fight and crane shots, and you know, there's one shot when Roz and I are fighting that is literally 60 feet in the air, and people were like, are those digi-doubles? Is that whatever? No, someone climbed a light tower and set up a camera for the middle of the fight. So to pull that off in a day with not a lot of sunlight to work with, I think it's the most incredible feat that we've ever done on the show. So from a production standpoint, from an effort standpoint, from a I think we pulled it off standpoint, that would be my favorite scene, maybe not for the season, maybe for the entire show. Pity I lost.
It's great. It's such a great scene though. I mean, it's so well done. Better.
Hi, I'm Tristan.
Hi.
We gave you a game show and a pin earlier at your photo op. We were told we could ask two questions each. Well,
okay.
One each.
Okay.
So he's gonna ask a funny question, I'll ask like a smart question.
Okay. Can I get the funny one first?
Alright, it's another fighting one. Who would win in a fight, Rocky Balboa or you, or Arrow with just a bunch of boxing glove arrows?
I mean, if I could keep, which Rocky are we talking? Rocky 1 I destroyed.
Rocky 4.
He's
like super Russia.
I mean, I always say that Arrow would win, but this might be the one exception. The Stallone that beat Drago in Russia on Christmas Eve is, I don't think that I could take that Stallone. Oh my God, he was frightening. Okay, next.
Okay, who and when will a new member of Arrow, of the Team Arrow, come to the show?
We get an honorary member of Team Arrow with superpowers in episode 15. Whenever I like give a direct answer to a question that's sort of spoilery, everyone's like, what do you want me to do? Just dance around them?
We love lobbing those grenades, though.
I love it so much.
Over here. All right, name's Tanner, big fan. Just wondering, can anyone else do the salmon ladder? And if so, can they do it as well?
David can do it.
Hey.
and make yourself right at home. What's happening with you, Mark? What's going on? Why? You're the only thing right now between us, you know? Look at these locks on this kid. Oh, how's your day? How's your day been going? Right? Early morning? You look tired. Are you tired? Fair enough. Mark, I need you to do me a favor. Get the hell out of here, buddy! Round of applause for Mark! Hello. It's good to see you. So we can't have this panel without a moderator. I brought my own moderator. The leading lady of SmackDown, all the way from the Menagerie of Madness, the Chief of Chaos, the Labyrinth of Lust, ladies and gentlemen, Eden! Woo! Hello. I don't know what the hell's going on. Hey, there it is. This is going well.
And we want it to keep going well. So we're going to keep going with your questions. Mark was just tired, so I'm here to field questions.
Mark was garbage.
So who's next? Who has a question?
Okay, again, Burgundy. Can I call you Burgundy?
Absolutely.
Burgundy. All right. Just wondering, can anyone else do the salmon ladder? And if so, can they do it as well as you?
No, well, yes.
I actually, Ollie, let me field this inquiry. I've been told that Barrowman can do the salmon ladder. I've also been told by Barrowman himself that Stephen is a bad kisser. Thank you, Burgundy. That will be all.
I think the internet disagrees with you on that one, but okay.
Are you ready for your next question, Stephen?
Okay.
All right. Who is next?
I'm Gideon, and I want to say... All right. So, do you know who's in the grave? And if so, it's Stephen. Eagle's dead, right?
I literally can't answer the question.
Allow me. What is your name?
Gideon.
Did you know that Mercury and Venus have no moons? You know? That's the answer to your question. Next.
First of all, love the fake accent, Cody.
Gentlemen!
Move this man!
I would like this man escorted out of the building.
Hey, you can
see. Oh, look at this outfit.
Look at yours.
I want to get up close with this one.
For real though, who's in the grave?
Look, may I actually feel this one?
Yes, I can feel this one.
Okay. I would say, based on your behavior, despite the fact that I beat him, you should mind your manners.
Wait.
He's a rough and tumble character.
Wait a minute. Beating me in a tag team contest is not beating me at all. I mean, what's to say, when to say, Green Arrow go one on one with Stardust? What? That is not why I'm here. No. Why I'm here is this gold bodice, this Slammy Award. Steven, celebrity moment of the year! Wow! I am a man of my word. I need a pin. Somebody give me the damn pen.
All right, while we're getting Stardust and pen, I think it's very important to know that once I have the Slammy, I'm going to sign it as well, and we're going to raffle it off for a young gentleman named Elijah Mainville. Yeah. WWE superstar Drax Shadow is his alter ego. And I think that we'll raise a good amount of money. We're gonna go to through his YouFund page or YouCaring page. Details on my Facebook page.
Possession for like 3 days. What was the question?
Oh yeah, Supernatural, that'd be a great idea. That'd be a great idea. We're both in Vancouver. Logistically, I don't think that you could actually cross over the worlds in like a meaningful storyline, necessarily, but that's not to say that I couldn't show up on Supernatural or Jensen and Jared couldn't show up on Arrow.
Also, the fans would give it a pass, for sure. Yeah, it doesn't have to have full bearing on storyline. It can just be something really fun.
I'm gonna keep my beanie on despite the fact that it's wet. Normally when I get dunked with water on Arrow, it is absolutely freezing. He just hightailed it out of here, didn't he? Alright.
Next question.
Steven, congrats on the Slammy.
Thank you.
Yeah!
So, and you know, the problem is that I'm not a violent person, but I have a hair-triggered temper, okay? So I'm gonna try to get through the rest of the panel without dropping an F-bomb or... I know that there are kids here, and let's just earmuff it for a second. No, I'm kidding. Anyway, keep going.
No, you handled that in class.
So at least one of us did.
Will you tell us that we failed this city, emphatically?
So, where would you consider us to be right now? Because I don't want to get it wrong. Like, I don't know if this is like technically Dallas, or if we're in Fort Worth, or Irving, or... Irving, Texas, you have failed this city.
But have you really?
Probably not.
Back on the ring.
Hi, Mr. Amell.
Hi.
My name is... Oh, hell, I forgot.
That would have been great if that was like the Indiana Jones team, where he goes, Dr. Jones, and they both go, yes. What's up?
Well, she said I can't ask my original question, so I'm going to ask you a different one.
Okay.
I'm
curious.
My son thinks that I'm going to ask you what your favorite color is, which we probably know that one.
Blue.
So, could you give a shout out to him on his birthday? This is his present. You are his present.
How old is he?
27, and he's sitting right
here. Hey. What?
Hey, that's funny.
I'm trying to do the math on the first question now. Where is this person? Oh, hey, man. Hey, come on up for a birthday high five, yeah?
Yeah!
Alright, ready? Hang on. No, come on up. Let's take a photo for your mom and see if we go. Here we are. Dad and Juju? I hope you both have enjoyed the panel, and honestly, we're in Texas, my third year here. I love it here. My wife is from Texas. I got in trouble on the internet because I like Texas. I love you guys. Thank you so much. On Arrow, so we get to do our own legends.
How does it feel now that you've had the four seasons under your belt and, you know, being able to know that, because genre shows like this don't always get a chance to breathe, and you guys are really right. Getting a nice run. So now that you've got four seasons under your belt, like, what is the feeling with the cast and everybody right now? Does it feel like you guys are the best is yet to come, or do you, what are you feeling at this point?
Well, I'm getting excited because I feel like the show was built to be 5 years long. Now, I told them it's not going to end after season 5.
Did you hear what Stephen Amell just said?
27 more episodes, we're done. No, it's not going to end after season 5, but we did build in a 5-year story. So to me, I feel like we're gaining a little bit of momentum right now, but we have a real opportunity through the end of this year and through season 5 to really put a button on that whole flashback story. There's so much stuff that we have to get done in the flashbacks that I almost feel like I'm putting off an assignment. Like, I talk to the writers every once in a while, I'm like, I've made a list of things from the flashbacks. Have you? No, we have. Okay.
I want to get to the audience questions too, because we got a lot of people lined up, but I did want to ask you briefly about playing Casey Jones in Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, because I'm a huge fan. And that really is like such a stinking cool character to be able to take on. So can you talk a little bit about what that experience was like, and was there a lot of freedom to interpretation on that role?
There was, and the thing that I like about it is that on paper, Casey Jones and Oliver Queen, both super-powerless vigilantes, would seem like a similar character, but believe me when I tell you that I don't find any Oliver in Casey. And so it was a really nice opportunity for me after 3 seasons of Arrow, and it's so difficult to schedule something during my hiatus because it's so short. The fact that I got to go and play that and stretch out a little bit was so much fun. And you know, for Turtles fans, there's really nothing that you're not getting in this movie. You're getting an awesome Shredder. Brian T is fantastic. Bebop and Rocksteady, and you know, from the Super Bowl commercial, it certainly looks like Krang.
I almost don't want to see more until it comes out because it's like
so
exciting.
There'll be one more. There'll be one more trailer. Yeah, we haven't really told the story of what it is yet.
Yeah, very cool. You got your hockey sticks skills down, I hope.
That's right.
All right, listen, I want to make this about you guys, so let's turn it over to the audience. We're going to start here, then we'll go here, and we'll go back and forth. Let's try to go as fast as we can because I know we got a lot of people in mind. Let's start right here.
Do you know who Artemis is, and will she be coming on the show soon or later?
Who?
Artemis. Yes.
I do know who Artemis is. I don't think that there are any plans to bring her on anytime soon.
Sorry.
Hi, my name is Elle, and I was wondering, like, what sort of martial arts what training you do to film the show, if there's any?
So the best way that I can put it is that, you know, I do my training with my trainer Thomas up in Vancouver, and but for the show, one of the things that I become more proficient at as we move through the seasons is the skill of fighting on television, the skill of fighting, you know, televised martial arts, I suppose, because I feel like fighting for the camera is a specific type of skill. If the camera is right there and the person that you're going to punch in the face is right here, there's a specific way that you should swing to make it look like that punch actually connects. And I've gotten to know that without having to be told anymore. I've also gotten a lot better at, during the pilot and during some early epi, and so it was scary because it felt like everything was going so perfectly that I was just waiting for the other shoe to drop. But then I got the call, and that was a little more than 4 years ago now.
Better.
Do the stunts scare you? Yes how or no will know.
They do. The stunts are scary. I had a fight in Ninja Turtles with Bebop and Rocksteady before they become the Bebop and Rocksteady that we all know. And the guy that was playing Rocksteady, his name is Stephen Farrelly, but WWE fans would know him as Sheamus. And Sheamus is utterly terrifying. And I had to run at him, and he had to pretend to headbutt me, and I was convinced that he was gonna kill me. And then, of course, with Arrow, there'll be certain things where, you know, it'll be a jump or swinging down from the tree or something, and I'm always very demonstrative and going, you're gonna let me do this, no one else is gonna do this, it's me, it's not a double. But I'm kind of afraid of heights. So I get up there and I go, and then I try to look cool.
Hi, I'm Sabrina.
Hi, Sabrina.
So supposedly all of my Felicity are gonna break up in the next episode or something bad like that.
You know what? I saw you were fishing for spoilers earlier. By talking about things like they had happened, trying to get me to slip up. You won't catch me, Sabrina. I will give you some hope, okay? Obviously, at some point this year, the chickens are gonna come home to roost for Oliver, and Felicity will likely find out that I have, a 10-year-old kid. Oliver. but I will tell you that if that happens, I promise that they will handle it like adults. Storytelling technique, and I don't enjoy the prevailing sense of dread that it has given both the fan base and, to be totally honest, the actors on the show, because nobody knows. When that scene was filmed at the beginning of the season, nobody knew. So that's been tough. It's been tough.
So like the reverse shot, there's nothing on the tombstone. You have no idea what's on that tombstone.
When I shot the scene, I went to the EPs and I said, do you know? And they said, even if we did, we wouldn't tell you. So I then asked them some questions and I said, okay, well, how should I react? You've got to give me a ballpark because I have to have something in my mind's eye. And they helped me with that.
Yeah.
Because we can't, you know, the scene in reverse has to make sense, right? Because it has to fit in seamlessly whenever we catch up to when that scene took place.
Okay. Right.
Who do you think would win in a battle, you or Zoom from Flash?
Ladies and gentlemen, Stephen Amell. This is our third Q&A together.
Yes, it is.
Third time's the charm. Thanks for coming back to Dallas.
I missed you.
Of course, I've missed you too. You complete me. So, the last time you were here was a fantastic build-up because where Arrow was at that point, it was where you had just kind of come back.
Yes.
And so, again, I think this week's episode is another great build-up because we've seen some really big things happen, and there's some huge tension coming up. So, I'm not going to ask for any spoilers, but is there anything you can tell us about what we can expect maybe in the next few episodes?
No.
No, okay.
No, there's, we have some returning favorites. Cupid is coming back to the show.
Cool.
Amy does a fantastic job with that character. I like that character. We are going to meet in a couple of later episodes a few villains from previous seasons that we haven't seen since then. And then there's that whole who's in the grave thing.
Right, yeah. Why don't you just tell everybody right now who's in the grave?
Guys, turn off your phones and I'll
just make it up. We'll put it out there, it'll go viral. It could be the wrong thing, you know.
I would say my only spoiler with that would be that just because it's something that we've teased since the beginning of the season does not mean that it won't happen until the end of the season.
Okay. Good.
So enjoy.
Maybe not that long. By the way, I'm hoping everybody's caught up on Arrow because there's probably going to be some spoilers that we discuss here, but I really enjoyed the way you Vader-ed Arrowman. That's something I saw somebody mention, and I thought that was a great way to put it. You Vader-ed him.
I Vader-ed him. Yeah, I cut his hand off. Well, he deserved it.
Yeah.
Somebody was saying to me earlier, a family came up to me and they were like, but you should have killed him. Look at what he's done. Look at everything that he has done. You should have killed him. You should have killed him. Why didn't you kill him? And I thought about it for a second, and I think that my answer is something that I'm going to be able to use going forward. Good decisions make for bad television. Bad decisions, good television.
Well, and based on what just happened, I think you may have even more motivation now to get your revenge at some point, depending on how things play out.
Yeah, the dangling carrot of my estranged son and his mother in danger is something that we're going to address very, very soon, I'm sure.
Another great standout episode, I think, this season was you guys did a phenomenal job of introducing Vandal Savage to the whole universe.
Yeah.
And the crossover episode with The Flash. I mean, that's going to be so much fun to shoot those episodes. There's so much going on in those episodes.
It's a ton of fun. We've had a ton of fun this year with the mystical elements, with the magical elements. Oh, a character that we have coming is Vixen from the animated series. So that's very exciting, and I mean, I've gotten to do stuff this year that I never envisioned being able to do. We have an episode of Legends of Tomorrow coming up called Star City 2046, which is exactly what it sounds like. And I get to do some things as Oliver Queen that I really never thought that I would do.
Yeah.
And we get to introduce an absolutely critical character took down a Reverse Flash, no problem. Someone hold him still, I'll punch him in the face. Done. I hope that answers your question. By the way, this causes some controversy, right? But I always get asked, you know, who would win in a fight? Green Arrow or Superman? Green Arrow or Batman? And of course, I'm always going to say Green Arrow. And I mean, always. Always, always, always. And then I caught some flack on the internet for saying that I would beat Batman in a fight. And part of it was caused by my own cousin who guffawed at the notion. Like, Robbie, you're being a dick. Sorry for my language. It really pissed me off. I know you like Batman, but keep your thoughts to yourself. By the way, he's on X-Files. Watch it if you want.
Hello, I'm Liam Inox. I'm the guy that did those Flight Tip Saturday photographs for you.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I have one question about, I'm an aspiring filmmaker, so I want to know, how is it like working with multiple different directors and the process you have to go through when they film one episode one way and the next episode a different way?
It's really interesting because we have directors on the show. We had a director who directs episode 415, and his name is Gregory Smith, and he is, I think, 2 years younger than I am, and worked with Greg Berlanti, our main executive producer, all the way back to Everwood, and is an incredible director and has a real eye for it and is so organized and highly efficient, and I love working with Greg. And then, meanwhile, our director on the episode that I just finished, Michael Schultz, is in his 70s. and he has a totally different tenor and speed. We've had James Bamford direct an episode this year, and he's our stunt choreographer, or, you know, is when he is not directing. He's also directing the episode that is airing this Wednesday. And so it's nice, because I'm always excited when the new director comes in, but by the time we get to the eighth day, I'm like, when are they going to get rid of this guy? And then, of course, I'm excited when they come back. So, and also, one of the great things that happens on a show as you get into year four is we've had a couple of brand new directors this year that are from within our crew, both James Bamford and Gord Veerhal, who directed the episode that just aired. And, you know, Gord has been the director of photography on Arrow since season one. And when he gets to move up and direct, that means that the head of the lighting department gets to come up and be the director of photography. So it's really neat to see, you know, guys that were dolly grips for the camera in season one are now operating, you know, B camera and C camera in season four. And that's a hyper rewarding thing. I've been working on a gift for the Arrow crew. I've been working on it since 2012, okay? On Monday, from 3 o'clock until 5 o'clock, the Stanley Cup is coming to set. Nice. You guys remember the Stars won the Cup, right? The Stanley Cup. It's mainly me taking a dig because they're all Canucks fans. Like, they're all really excited. They're like, is the Cup coming? Is the Cup coming? And I go, yeah, how else is it going to come to Vancouver? Double-edged sword for them, but they'll be happy ultimately.
What a guy. Right here.
Hi, my name is Ian. Hi, Ian. Is your favorite Pokemon?
Episodes of the show, we would have tons of time to put fights together. That's not so much the case anymore. I'm really learning those fights on the fly, and I'm really good at coming in talking to our, or I'd like to think I'm pretty good at coming in, talking to our fight choreographer, Stephen Amell says he's excellent at, and having him say, here are these eight moves, you know, pop, 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 pop. And I, what? Okay, show me again. Pop, 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 pop. I go in, I kind of do it, I do a little bit quicker, and then roll the cameras. So that's something that I've gotten better at.
I'll say it, you are pretty good.
Thank you.
Right over here.
Hi, my name is Crystal. I was wondering, how is it like to play a hero, and would you ever change that to play a villain?
Yes. I actually got a little bit worried. I got a little bit worried because my first, you know, six or seven jobs, the only time that I wasn't playing a villain, I was playing a hooker. So you start taking long looks at yourself in the mirror, going, is there something wrong? Why are people identifying this one very evil trait in me? I do enjoy playing someone that is heroic and that always strives to do the right thing, even when that doesn't always mean making the right decision. But some of my favorite moments for Oliver is when we see a flaw in him, when we see the elements that aren't heroic, because I think that humanizes the character, makes it a little bit more relatable, and, you know, I like making people mad.
I saw some dark stuff with you asking where Damien Dark was, so it's kind of a darker side of Oliver there.
Yeah, and that was important. There are a few elements of the character that, you know, as we move through the show, and as we keep trying to push the envelope, you can't push it so far that you get away from the core elements of the show that made people enjoy it in the first place.
Right.
I mean, you can certainly go to the well one too many times, but at the same time, that's the character. You know, I read online, I know a lot of fans were upset that, you know, Oliver wasn't truthful with Felicity, and I mean, I thought that it was fascinating, if not a lot of fun. Because
yeah.
It's obviously going to come back and bite him in the ass.
Can you
shoot a bow and arrow, if so, good?
That's so awesome. That's like the best way to ask that question.
Yes. And yes.
Fantastic. Thanks. Let's keep all the questions.
I wish every question was like that.
right here.
Hi, I'm Mackenzie, and I was wondering, how did you get the role of the Arrow, and how many more seasons do you think there will be?
That's a great question. I got the role of Oliver Queen because the show that I had been on previously on HBO was canceled. So it was canceled in late December, and at the time I was working as a guest star on Private Practice, and the role of, you know, the pilot of Arrow came up. Robbie, my cousin, told me about it, and was like, you should audition for this because, you know, they want me to audition, and I read it, and all I could picture was you doing it, and it pissed me off. So you should definitely read for that. And I said, I'm sure I will. And the only thing that was unnerving about the audition process was how seamless it was. I was the first person to audition. Shortly after the audition, the director of the pilot told me that I was going to be cast as Oliver. But then I still had to go and test for the network and test for the studio and then be approved by the head of CBS. Not just the CW.